Right. Hello, everybody. We are back after a short pause on our revenue architecture webinar series. It's the last episode, actually, that you are watching right now. Today, with me is Patrick from the European side, from the European team of Winning by Design. Patrick is very involved in training, enablement. He's a director of training and enablement, I think, is your exact title with Winning by Design, right, Patrick?
Yeah, that's our learning and development. I mean, it doesn't,
I'm very excited actually for the topic that we are going to discuss today. It's, as you can see on the screen, maximizing impact through frontline managers. So we are going to talk a lot about enablement. We are not going to talk about only enablement for frontline managers. We are going to touch on, in general, the different trends that we are seeing in the enablement world, because it's a field that has been changing a lot, I would say, in the last few years. My feeling is that a lot of companies are starting to realize more and more the power that good enablement, good training can have on sales teams and also on their managers. But before that, welcome, Patrick, to our episode.
Thank you very much. Delighted to be here. Really appreciate it, George. Thank you.
Yeah, if you'd like, maybe you can share just a few words about yourself, your role at Winning by Design, and then we can dive deeper into the things.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. So currently at Winning by Design, I'm looking after the training side of the house, while also supporting our customers from scoping to advisory services and helping them sort of achieve impact and then the enablement deliverables that they're trying to do. I've been in enablement for about 10 years now. I started off in selling, and then I moved into enablement. I saw the opportunity to, I suppose, affect more people with enablement than just maybe myself selling to a handful of customers. So I've been there ever since. I've had the opportunity to work in many different environments, from startup all the way to grown up, and different go-to-market motions as well. So I've been very lucky. I hit enablement at a time when it, in about 2016, when it started exploding into the SaaS world. And so I've been on a super journey since then.
Right. It's very interesting because maybe we can compare a bit what was 10 years ago and how enablement looks right now. I think there are a lot of changes, right? Starting from the very basic, that I think like once upon a time or some time ago, it was primarily assumed that sales need to be enabled, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas now we are speaking a lot about revenue enablement, go-to-market enablement. This is one of the maybe changes, but there is a lot more. I'm sure you can share some interesting stuff.
That's a good question. I have to cast my mind all the way back then. I wonder at the time when I first started, did maybe enablement have a proverbial seat at the table? My thoughts are they maybe didn't, from a seat at the revenue table and a discussion on how maybe training development and go to market was shaped. I think now, you know, there's a lot of strong enablement leaders out there who really have a voice in organizations, which is key because they can help advise and shape, to your point, not only sales, but the whole go-to-market teams. And, you know, at Winning by Design, we talk about the bow tie. So not only the right side, but the left side as well. I think now as we share, I mean, AI is the big word, right? When we're thinking about enablement now. But I think what we've seen in the market in the SaaS world, and unfortunately the crash that happened, we're trying to pick up the pieces of that. And I think enablement now will be front and center of that. And what I mean by that is, you know, there was that growth at all costs. You know, we'll invest a lot of money here. We'll get a lot of people in and we'll grow as quick as we can. Now businesses in the SaaS world, it's about sustainable growth. How do we get and maximize everything from the workforce that we have? And I think enablement now is best place for that. How do you maximize the lifetime value of a person that comes into your organization, not only for their development, but also for the better of the company? So rather than just let's hire more, it's how do we get the people that we have better? And I think, again, enablement is placed and mature enough to be able to do that.
Right. A couple of things that I have in my mind. On the one hand, as in our audience, usually we have also people that are founders of smaller companies around five to 10 million of ARR, and we have also viewers that are like between 10 to 30, let's say, million of annual revenue. Can you maybe speak about when is the best time to set up enablement, if there is such thing as best time? How does it look like when you are small, when you don't have your full org chart yet, and when it grows? And what do you like to say we usually include in an enablement team? Because I've seen debates on that as well. Like, what are the different roles within such an enablement team as a company grows and scales?
Sure. Unfortunately or fortunately, I've had the times when I've maybe stepped in as the first enablement person into a business, like you said, as a startup, maybe 10 million, 20 million ARR. And I don't think maybe enablement was needed at that time. And having that experience and talking maybe to recruiters in the past that are looking to bring their first enablement person is, you know, my question will always be, well, how many do we have in the teams? How many managers are there? Because a lot of times I think at that phase of a business, you need really great leaders. So if you can have a really good sales leader and a really good customer success management leader there with experience, I think it's enough for them to be able to handle all the coaching, the training, and the processes in that. I mean, when should enablement be brought in? I imagine as they're starting to scale, maybe we're looking at a Series B round funding that's just occurred, and the business is being encouraged to maybe spread out into different markets. I think at that stage, maybe enablement one or two might be able to be brought in to start supporting the laydown of proper processes and procedures within the business. Within an enablement team, I mean, everybody has their different points of view of who they would like in an enablement team. I know I would like somebody who can do data because that's maybe not my strong suit, but you definitely, you would need at the start, and then again, this is just my opinion, probably generalists, enablement talent that can have the ability to work in multiple areas within a business, whether it's onboarding, whether it's ongoing leadership, content management. If you can get one or two people at the start that have that generalist's lens, I think that's a good way to begin.
Right. And what I like to say usually to companies that are at around Series A stage, because we're doing revenue operations, you know, and usually at Series A, some companies don't yet have, you know, don't still have revenue operations, or they have one person who is generalist. And usually in one of the definitions of revenue operations, the one that we are using, enablement is one of the pillars of revenue operations, right? And we are saying to usually those Series A founders, if you can find one generalist in terms of revenue operations who understands process, who understands technology, data, but also enablement, that's the best thing that you can have, right?
And then
after that, at Series B, you can have professionals that are really, you can have an enablement professional, you can have a CRM, for example, experts, and so on.
Yeah. And again, I think, George, to your point, in that if you're thinking about that person in that Series A, if they have strong leadership around them, strong leaders in those go-to-market organizations, then, you know, they'll feel supported with that. And they'll also have to have a culture. I mean, it's important to have that culture of learning. No matter what phase you are within your growth as a business, if the culture brings, you know, a growth mindset, a learning mindset, and has a foundation of that, then the business will be well placed, because it's just it's known within the go-to-market organization that we're here to learn as well as do our jobs.
Right. Maybe one more thing which I'm seeing, or I saw quite often in the past. At the beginning, it was very hard for founders, especially the ones that didn't understand sales so well, to invest in enablement. I've seen sometimes enablement being treated as a cost rather than some kind of an investment, as many other things in go-to-market, right? I think in enablement, this is one of the fights that we are sometimes trying to have, really trying to prove the value of enablement. Do you see this trend, like, do you see this kind of thing changing right now?
Yes, and again, I think it comes back to where our yeah. businesses within this SaaS world, and they're now at a, hey, we have to be sustainable, we have to show growth, a sustainable growth, and everything and everyone that's in this business has to be, you know, maybe contributing towards that. And I think enablement was shifting towards that anyway. There's always been a need to, or not a need, but maybe a self-imposed drive to prove value. And it can be difficult because, you know, the word contribution, you know, did you contribute? Because there's many different variables. If an enablement team rolls out a training, there's many different variables within that. Their manager might be coaching. They might be getting support from, you know, marketing. So who really is defining that impact? But I think, yes, data is extremely important now. The leading indicators, behavioral change, and then also the lagging indicators. And that comes right at the start from really understanding, if we're going to build this program, why are we doing it? What's the need for it? And what's impact going to look like? And that typically has to be in your baseline data and values that you pull out. And then at the end, we're able to look back and see, you know, have we been successful with that? Or did we contribute towards that? But I do believe, I read a comment from somebody a week or two ago where I think the statement was, if you're an enablement, you think you're there to help people learn, you're in the wrong job. And as human beings, we like to say it's either A or B, but it can be both. Right? As an enablement, yes, you're there to drive value for the business and ROI, but you're also there to help people learn and to develop and grow. When you're in school, your teacher's there to teach you and for you to learn and grow. When you're in a company, the enablement, the L&D function, they take on that function as well as driving ROI and revenue.
Yeah. Yeah. And here you're referring to this part of enablement where really, for example, sellers, CSMs, marketing people as well, they're learning new knowledge, right? Learning new skills with which they can get better. And also there is this other type of enablement where there's just a new process, let's say, has been optimized or brought to the organization. I can maybe share some insights around that, because as like in revenue operations, we are often either optimizing a process or just implementing something new. And what I see in some of the companies, like, it's natural for them to think that, like, after delivery is finished, we're done, right? And then just some of them don't have this kind of instinct to think about, okay, how do we drive adoption? Mm-hmm. And not within just one training or by recording a video, but how do we make sure this is a continuous process? We monitor it, we improve it, and so on.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. The reinforcing of it. I mean, you know, not many people are maybe into boxing or fighting, but, you know, if a fighter is learning a punching combination, he's not going to do it once or twice. That he or she is going to be in the gym repeating until it's second nature to them. So the other thing as well, and just to touch on that point about the ROI, while you do have the tangibles, which are, you know, did we increase or contribute to, you know, win rate or increasing our market or segment selling of products, there's also what, you know, recruiting want to hear, right? Recruiters want to be able to go out to candidates and say, if you come in here, we'll develop you. We have a world-class enablement function, right? So that drives their targets as well, because they're charged with going out and getting new people. Then we're retaining people, right? So there's a cost that's associated. If you bring in a salesperson and they leave you within 6 to 12 months, you're losing money, right? Yeah. So if you don't fill that seat, you're losing money. So recruiting can bring people in and say, you know, you'll get looked after here. We'll keep people if we train them and develop them and they feel that they're being taken care of. So not only are you benefiting the business, but you're also benefiting other teams as well as the individual.
Yeah, exactly. One of the additional benefits to enablement, because usually, like, the best people like to continue to be upskilled, right? And to learn more. So it's like very natural, you know, for them to come to your organization if you have this kind of function. All right, maybe let's get closer now to the topic of the conversation, the true topic of the conversation. Yes. We've decided to focus on frontline managers. Of course, sometimes when you have the enablement professionals focus, let's say, on sellers primarily, I've seen other functions be a little bit jealous, right? Mm-hmm. Why I, as a CSM, don't get this kind of training that sellers, for example, are getting. This is one of the issues that we are seeing. But also, like historically, and I think even nowadays, like sometimes we are forgetting also to train our frontline managers, mm-hmm. who, to a large degree, are determining what we are going to bring in terms of sales, right? Because they're responsible for people. What's your take on that?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I've been in organizations, like I said, where it's either been a startup or a scaling. And like that, most resources will go to the individual contributor, wherever they sit in the go-to-market motion, because they are customer facing. They will drive either revenue, new business, or reoccurring revenue or upsells. And so, rightly so, the business will start to function. And so frontline managers who maybe, you know, they'll get it maybe at some point, but maybe a couple of years down the road as the business starts to get into a rhythm. But they are, you know, frontline managers are one of the linchpin, really. Not only to support enablement as a scalable factor within that, but they will, you know, a manager might look after 10 individual reps. And if they're taught how to coach and support their teams, again, they'll drive performance, but less people will be inclined to leave. So they're having that effect as well. So the frontline managers, yeah, they're very much important within this process.
Right. I know you have prepared a few slides with an interesting research on the impact, basically. That's
absolutely. Yeah. Let me share my screen for those who love data. let me see. Make sure I get this up. Okay. So just to give a bit of context to this, George, at Winning by Design, we developed a way of training teams that could be done in a really quick process, you know, within a month or within a quarter, to, you know, drive an impact. So we call them impact sprints. So what we do is we pick an individual one or two micro skills that a go-to-market rep could focus on. And then we do training and subsequent coaching workshops over a block of maybe three or four coaching. And we measure leading and lagging indicators. So we'll measure from a lagging perspective, you know, what is it that they're trying to achieve? Maybe it's that they're trying to drive urgency through uncovering critical event. Okay, we're going to measure that. And we're going to look at that at the end from a baseline perspective. We also will look at behavioral change. So are the reps actually engaging in this? They have to do self-assessment through scorecards, listening to their call recording, and then their managers will also have to do that and provide coaching for them. Because we have found now that companies aren't, you know, they don't have the time and the resources to invest in eight month long programs. They want to see impact really quickly. They want to see ROI really quickly. And we feel that this is a really good way to do that. So that's just providing the context. So this first graph, and you and I were chatting about this beforehand. What we were doing here was measuring individual contributors. But with this company that we were working with, so they're a publicly traded company, their project management platform, we got really lucky here. So we actually started off with one cohort. So we had one cohort, one vertical within their business and all of their reps and their managers. And another vertical in the business said, we would like this too. So at the same time, which was a lot of work, we were running two of these impact sprints in correlation for the exact same skills that they were looking to achieve. So it was almost like a proper research study where both were doing it and we could. So what we found was, yes, we had some impact with the reps, but there was this once we went through this, we found this secondary, I suppose, set of data, which was almost telling us about how important managers and frontline managers were. So you'll see in this graph here, so this is coaching impact on behavioral change. So what we were looking at here is with the reps that achieved, who received feedback and coaching from their managers, 60% of them passed. So they will pass at the end after going through this process. Of 14%, so 14% of reps who did not receive coaching passed. So that means that these reps here, and I'm not super at math, but it was almost like a 300% or more increase when reps were receiving manager coaching and feedback. So we know, and we've always known how important managers are when it comes to coaching. This just gave us a sample size data. Now the sample size is 40. So, you know, it's not massive, but it's a start to be able to see that. So that was really interesting. And then the next one, so this is it in a little bit more detail. And it's almost looking at it from another perspective. So we know in the first graph, we are proving ourselves right by saying we know that managers can coach. Here's the evidence. With this one now, what we're saying is if frontline managers don't buy into this program, the training's not going to stick. So here we have the two groups. So this is group A and this is group B. This is the beauty of us running these with two different verticals at the same time. So in group A, we had highly engaged managers who were filling out scorecards, giving coaching. They were engaged with us in a Slack channel. They were showing up to their trainings. And what we noticed is there was a 60% improvement on their reps asking impact questions. So trying to uncover what impact customers were trying to achieve. And we had 50% improvement on uncovering critical event, which is a sign of driving urgency for a deal and making sure that deals don't go dark. On the other hand, we had the exact group doing, or a different group doing the exact same things. But unfortunately, due to whatever scenario was going on within their business environment, this group of managers, frontline managers, were not engaged. Now, while we see higher starting point in their baseline, there's only a 6% improvement and a 10% improvement. So that, you know, and again, this was data that we weren't even looking at. It just happened that it fell this way. So on our first graph, we are seeing, we know instinctively managers, if they coach, they improve. Here's some evidence that that works. In this graph, what we're seeing is if you don't get buy-in from your frontline managers, your training programs in enablement are not going to work. So what does this tell us? It tells us that frontline managers are so important in enablement to helping us execute on what the business is trying to do.
Right. It's very hard, I think, or at least compared to finding research on other go-to-market topics, it's very hard to find good research on enablement and the impact it has, right? So I think it's very valuable that we show this data. So thanks for that. And I wrote down a few questions as you were presenting that. Maybe to ask you, from your experience, who, if there is something like an ideal version, who is the best person or the best team to train frontline managers? And do you see this being more of an external party or an internal person or team?
I mean, that's a really good question. And again, I suppose the answer in short is depends. Depends on, do you have the talent within your enablement team, within the business to be able to do this? Do you have the resource? Do you have the time? I mean, you could have all the talent in the world. You just not might have the time. I think internally, from what I've seen from and working as part of leadership enablement teams, it's a cross-functional collaboration. If you want to do this right, it's not just enablement supporting the frontline managers. HR need to have a piece of the conversation as well. And you should be working in tandem and building, you know, roadmaps and journeys for the lifetime value of all of your frontline managers, from team lead all the way to senior executives. The best programs I've been a part of have both enablement and HR, and they map it out together and they know the stages that they can come into. There are times when, and you know, we're a consultancy firm that specialize in frontline managers, that we're brought in to support. So, and again, that depends on where the customer is in their maturity. They might have the expertise and the SMEs within the organization to do this. Or other times we've had where they just don't have the time, George. They're just have so many projects that they need some support, and that's okay too. Companies that buy into our frameworks, our SPICED frameworks, our REX frameworks for leadership, once they've embedded those, they typically will come to us for support to help reinforce that with them.
So it would depend.
It would depend on the situation.
Right. And one more question, which maybe also can be answered with it depends, but let's try.
Okay.
Like, you have a lot of experience in enablement and training. Have you identified a good, let's say, a ratio, let's say on a monthly or quarterly, I don't know, basis, how much time should like sellers or frontline managers or CSMs be spending in some kind of enablement training?
Yeah, really, you know, really good. Again, that is, it depends. I mean, ultimately, you don't want to get in the way of their job. And look, I've seen different things like Salesforce. They do what's called a 2-2-2 matrix, where they only have the first 2 weeks of the first 2 months within a quarter. That's when enablement needs to happen. That's when it happens. You're also going up against marketing enablement and product enablement. They might have to come in at some point, and they might be separate from your organization. And so you're trying to organize that as well. I believe that we're probably moving towards an on-demand, always-on style of enablement. So while there might be programs and projects that are either ongoing or part of onboarding, there should be a foundation where, you know, if a rep decides that they want to, you know, upskill themselves or reinforce their discovery skills or the negotiating skills, that something's there for them, that they can do it on their way to work, going for a walk, on their lunch break, that they don't have to take themselves away from the job.
Exactly. And if they are incentivized well, that shouldn't be a problem at all, because it will be valuable for them, for the company. So everybody wins, right?
Yeah, correct.
All right. What else did I want to ask you? I was thinking of, of course, maybe let me ask you, there is one question that we cannot go without. Maybe you know which question is. You alluded to this at the beginning, but we have AI, right? And we didn't mention AI in this episode. And AI is also impacting how we are doing enablement. Maybe can you share some best practices, observation, how is AI impacting the role of training and enablement?
Well, I think at the moment, from what I've seen, you know, I know everybody has grand ideas of where it can go in the future, but if we think about the present, AI is helping enablement from a productivity standpoint. So, you know, from an enablement standpoint, it might be things like you're able to bring in a platform that allows reps to do cold calling with an AI system. So you're freeing up time for not only managers, but also enablement personnel to work on other parts of the business or projects that they need to do. So I think right now it's supporting them from a productivity standpoint. It's supporting reps from a productivity standpoint, where they're, you know, it's helping them create, you know, value messaging or emails or things that they, you know, would normally spend a lot of time on. So that's where I feel it is right now. Some of the cool things that I've seen, for example, I can't remember the name of the platform, but, you know, if you have a global business, and maybe there are certain pockets within the company or certain territories that you don't have native language speakers, you know, you can create a normal, maybe in your native language training or short video, and this will change it into the language of whichever territory that, you know, they're doing it in, and therefore they're getting to hear the training within their native language. So there are some of the small things that I've seen that could be impactful.
Yeah, so AI for productivity, which is one of the most common use cases, not only in enablement, but productivity is one of the best things that we can achieve through AI right now at that moment.
Absolutely, yeah.
Right, all right. some like one of the other things that wanted to ask you while I was hearing you share interesting stories is because you're working and you've worked with managers, you've worked with individual contributors as well. Sometimes when you are trying to change the mind of a manager, I've seen sometimes it's hard because they are coming into the organization, they have already built some skill sets, they have a mindset of how something needs to be achieved, right? And sometimes we have those people, especially in sales, that are just hard to change, right? So my question is, how coachable are frontline managers in general and compared to individual contributors?
I think it goes back to our first conversation where we were talking about, you know, frontline managers typically are the last to get any type of enablement. And so I think what you naturally find is when you do offer enablement to frontline managers, they seize it with both hands, and they're extremely grateful and engaged in general to be part of it. It's an opportunity not only for them to receive training, but it's more importantly an opportunity for them to spend time with their peers and have that peer-to-peer learning and contact and understand, you know, what are you doing? And, oh, you're in the same scenario that I'm in, I'm not alone. So I think, you know, my experience has been, you know, generally there's always outliers that they've been very responsive to not only that, but to one-to-one coaching as well. I think it all stems from making sure that you create a safe space, a learning space, a space that they can come into and feel okay with not knowing what they don't know. And then creating that, opening that space, that it's not always about you, the sage on the stage, that it's about creating opportunities and activities where they can be with their peers to hear from them, because that's typically where they get the best insights. Yeah. So on a whole, I think they're very engaged, but that's just my experience.
Great. Yeah, that's a great observation. By the way, I recently attended a training on negotiations, and there were a lot of sellers naturally there. And from this training, that's also something like what I saw is that trainers, like not the trainers, but the sellers, like, and there were a lot of managers there. They were super grateful, first of all, that they were there. And second of all, this peer-to-peer learning, the opportunity to learn from other people was super powerful for them. And they enjoyed that very much.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. I mean, for any type of training, you know, you have to give them the what's in it for me.
Yeah.
You know, anybody who's, you know, and any session you're going to do, there's always going to be one or two people that aren't engaged. That's just life. When you were in school, there was always one or two people that weren't engaged. They're probably professional sports people now at this stage. You know, that's just life. You're never going to get 100% of people in a room, but you definitely need to make sure that they know what's the benefit for them being there. What are they going to get out of it? And why should I, you know, leave my day job to come and do this? Because they're adults, and you know that is part of adult learning. You know what's in it for me.
Right. All right. Great conversation so far. I think we're going towards the end. Maybe one last question. So we are in 2024. The last few years have been a lot of changes, right? Mm-hmm. Now with AI that we mentioned, we're seeing even more and more changes. I know it's hard to predict, but how do you see enablement changing in the future? How do you see enablement in, let's say, 2030? What do you believe, if some enablement leaders are watching us, what do you believe are the skills of the successful enablement leader in the future?
Oh, of the enablement leader in the future, how are things going to change? I would hope, I can't look in the future, but you know, to me, it's always about the basics and the humanity within the role. And bringing your full human self into the job. And if we're talking about leaders in the future with AI, you know, ultimately you're not going to be working with AI. You're still going to be working with people within your team. Might it be less people in your team? Yeah, because I'm sure AI is going to remove maybe some of the entry-level roles. But fundamentally, you're still going to be working with people. And so managers in the future will hopefully still be interested in developing people, wanting to work with people. And there's three things that I always talk about, especially when it comes to the likes of coaching and working with people. If you can listen, if you can have silence, and you can be curious, you know, if you can bring those in the future, in 2030, when AI is rife, I think you'll be doing okay as a frontline manager.
Right. And I think that's a great sentence to end this conversation with. So enablement is all about being human, understanding the other person who you are working with, and being empathetic, being able to step in their shoes, understand their needs, and collaborate, right?
Absolutely.
So, like, skills that are, I mean, that will sustain for the next years as well.
You know, I'll leave you with this. What is business? Business, people equals business. Business equals people. That's it. In its most fundamental form, you can't have business without people.
Right. Great. Well, let's put those words as an end. Thanks so much, Patrick. I think we shared a lot of useful insights.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me, George. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you again. Thanks for everybody who is watching this video. We are going to keep producing great and hopefully insightful content. So stay tuned. And again, thank you. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.